Welcome to worship with the Strathclyde Methodist Circuit. It's really good to be with you, whether you're joining us on YouTube, Facebook, whether you're on the phone or whether you have a hard copy. It's always good to worship with you. I will be leading the worship today alongside Joanne Smith, a worship leader from Netherton. And our theme centres along growing our faith. Our call to worship. Lord God, you are said to be our gardener. Come and till our hearts and grow our faith that we would all glorify you. Amen. And now I'm going to hand over to Joanne.
Our first reading is from the Old Testament and it's Ezekiel chapter 17 verses 22 to 24. I'm going to intersperse the reading with moments of prayer. This is what the Sovereign Lord says. I myself will take a shoot from the very topmost part of a cedar and plant it. I will break off a tender sprig from its topmost shoots and plant it on a high and lofty mountain. Lord, lift me high and place me where I can grow. On the mountainous heights of Israel, I will plant it. It will produce branches and bear fruit and become a splendid cedar. Lord, let me bear witness to your love and share it. Birds of every kind will nest in it and they will find shelter in the shade of the branches. All the trees of the forest will know that I, the Lord, bring down the tall tree and make the low tree grow tall. Lord, let me be a haven and a help to all who are needy. I dig up the green tree and I make the dry tree flourish. Lord, you are my king and sovereign. Your will be done. Lord, let me not presume to judge others. I, the Lord, have spoken and I will do it. Lord, let me always be confident in your love and words to me. Amen. In the passage in Ezekiel, it's all about taking cuttings. And there's lots of reasons why you might take a cutting. You might take a cutting because there's been some damage to a plant and it's not vigorous anymore. And that can be because the soil's exhausted. Or in the case of the lavender that I'm doing just now, it was because it was hit by a bad frost late on in the spring. So when you take a cutting, you're looking for a strong, healthy shoot. And it will give you the same genetic material as was in the parent plant. So I'm going to do that now. So I'm going to take off all the stuff I don't need, just to reduce the transpiration. And I've got a little bit of the old heel from the plant. I'm going to dip it in some hormone rooting powder. Make a wee hole in some pre-soaked compost, push it in and carry it over. And I do that right round the side of the plant. Basically I'm controlling the medium. In the passage it was a cedar cutting that was taken, and cedar here is symbolic for the kings of Judah. And this new shoot that's talked about, it stands for a future king through whom the Lord would restore the glory and vigour of David's dynasty. And Jesus is the fulfilment of that prophecy. To take a cutting is to make a commitment to the future. For God has provided everything it needs to achieve its potential within the plant material. But to flourish, it needs a gardener to study it, to nurture it, to water it, and to care for it. And so it is with faith. Other Christians, Christian writing and art and music have perhaps caused the shoots of faith to grow in us. But it will never be the splendid cedar if we neglect it. No new life will come to it and find solace and shelter If our faith is not growing to stand tall and be a beacon, a blessing, a haven to others who need us. The Lord has spoken and has done what he said he would do. He has given us the potential to grow. Let us be the gardeners of faith and hope. And now we have our first hymn. That's from Singing the Faith, number 104, God Moves in a Mysterious Way.
Gillian are going to lead our prayers of thanks now. They've collected some objects from nature and designed a beautiful collage containing stones and twigs, flowers and seeds. I wonder how the natural world creates a sense of thankfulness for you or speaks to you about the mystery of God. We begin with their journey into the woods.
Dear Lord, you made an amazing world for us to live in. We praise you because you have created a world that is beautiful and awe-inspiring. Thank you for your wonderful creation. It is so vast, yet you know and love everything that is in it. Father, we thank you for every blade of grass, so tender and fresh. For every tiny seed that blooms into colourful, sweet-smelling flowers. For every tree that stands tall in the forests and on the hillside. For every plant in the rich earth. Teach us to appreciate all that you have made for us. Forgive us when we harm the things that you have created for us to enjoy, the fresh streams and rivers, the trees and green fields. Help us to preserve and protect everything you made and to stop those who selfishly destroy it. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
The parable of the growing seed. Jesus went on to say, "The kingdom of God is like this. A man scatters seed in his field. He sleeps at night, is up and about during the day, and all the while the seeds are sprouting and growing. Yet he does not know how it happens. The soil itself makes the plants grow and bear fruit. First the tender stalk appears, then the ear, and finally the ear of corn. When the corn is ripe, the man starts cutting it with his sickle because harvest time has come. What shall we say the kingdom of God is like?" asked Jesus. "What parable shall we use to explain it?" "It is like this. A man takes a mustard seed, the smallest seed in the world, and plants it in the ground. After a while, it grows up and becomes the biggest of all plants. It puts out such large branches that the birds come and make their nests in its shade." Jesus preached his message to the people using many other parables like these. He told them as much as they could understand. He would not speak to them without using parables, but when he was alone with his disciples, he would explain everything to them. Amen.
I love being in the garden. I love visiting public gardens. I have a friend also who likes gardens. She says that you know you're getting old when you not only watch the gardening programmes, but you look forward to them coming on. I'll let you draw your own conclusions on that one. The Bible is full of references and stories relating to gardens and plant growth. Because that biblical world was so dependent upon crops, on vegetation, on fruit, because they were all tantamount to the thriving of their communities. And we too now are being urged to return to a more extensive plant-based life, both because of our physical well-being, but also to address the global warming. Changes we are being encouraged to make are part of our faith. For our faith in Christ calls us to take care of ourselves and to be mindful of others, to live out the kingdom values, values that help everyday community to flourish. The illustration of faith like a mustard seed suggests that our faith is organic and that as an organic component has the ability to grow in all kinds of directions, so we will be all kinds of different shapes. And our faith will not be expressed in exactly the same way. After all, there are millions, if not trillions, of plants, each with their own identity. Plants that first germinate and then sprout and shoot and grow and blossom and fruit and seed and rest. In the same way, our faith also needs to germinate and sprout and root and so on and so on. You know, you get the picture. And in all the different ways in which our faith grows, we find we are dependent upon our God. For it is our God who makes our faith grow. It is the Father who is the gardener. Yeah. We have to play our part, both for ourselves and others, but it's still our God who makes us grow. Apostle Paul had some thoughts about planting and sowing and growing in faith. Let's hear what he has to say to the church at Corinth. What, after all, is Apollos? And what is Paul? only servants from whom you came to believe as the Lord had assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God has been making it grow. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The one who plants and the one who waters have one purpose, and they will each be rewarded according to their labour. For we are co-workers in God's service. You are God's field, God's building. We are co-workers. It makes sense then that we are all gardeners of faith, some to sow, some to seed, some to water, to feed, to prune, to harvest, to prepare, and then all of us to feast in celebration of our Creator. We'll not all be sharing faith in the same way, but we are designed to play our part and to co-work with God in growing faith, in growing the kingdom of faith, where the ways of Christ are evident in all aspects of life. As well as seeing ourselves as apprentice gardeners, we can also imagine ourselves as plants. Wonder what you would be. Plants that need to receive the gifts and graces of others, where we are open to having ideas sown by others, and where we can be spiritually fed by those around us. Or maybe pruned by the challenges laid down, or reaped by someone who sees a real potential in us and encourages us. We need one another for our faith to grow. I came to faith when I was young, and what I've discovered is that faith reflects very much the seasons of nature. Sometimes I'm experiencing a winter and it's cold, and nothing really seems to happen. And sometimes it's more like spring with a million possibilities and desires. And there are times when I need to deepen my roots, times of flourishing and times of bearing fruit. Although these never seem to be quite enough, do they? I'm sure you relate to what I'm saying, whether you see yourself as a mighty oak of righteousness or the humble bluebell that grows in the shadows. It's God who makes us grow. It's others who nurture our growth. But what do we have to do in order to feed our faith? What action can we take to nurture our growth? One way is to use a framework. Let's think of it as a trellis or an obelisk. Something that supports us in our call to grow, to mature, to become as developed as the mustard seed that provides branches in which the birds can nest. It's a great image, isn't it? Or another thought is to become like a vine entwined around a trellis in order to flourish year on year, bearing the grape which is delicious to both eat and drink. A fruit made very much for celebration. A trellis isn't a living thing in itself, but something that promotes life. My trellis, my framework, includes things like praying each day for both myself and others, reading the Bible devotionally and not just the bits that I like, taking time to think about the day, what's been good and where can I thank God, and what's been really what you could call a source of disappointment, particularly maybe a disappointment in myself. And how can the Holy Spirit make that different? Also includes time enough to rest and to enjoy the things that make me me. And inclusion of the world's problems, usually when I'm watching the news, and asking, what difference can I make? How can I respond? How can I pray? And of course, meeting with other believers to worship, to share faith. Those are the things that make up my framework, my trellis. They're particularly valuable when my faith is dry or when it sits on a plateau, because it brings a certain amount of discipline. And it's there to train me, to grow me, something to be fixed on so that I grow in the right direction. We can all have a framework or a trellis or even an obelisk, if you like, that helps us to grow. You can even design your own if you want. A framework helps us to remain faithful. And even though it's our own framework, it helps the whole body of Christ grow. If you're thinking of Googling a faith framework or a trellis, you'll find one under the title Rule of Life. But don't let that put you off. Or maybe you'd like to look at this Methodist way of life, because that in itself is a ready-made framework. In all them frameworks, prayer is a fundamental aspect of growing our faith. So now I'm going to plug some sessions on prayer that Bob will be facilitating next month. We can all have something that we can bring to that table. We all have something that we can take away. We are, after all, a praying people, and it would be good for us to go and share our experiences and thoughts. And you'll find the dates on the closing slide. It is God who makes us grow. It is God's Spirit within us that gives us life and ensures we grow into the person we were made to be. And we can seek the support, the trellis, the framework that we need to see us through the dry times. And a framework that is there to support us when we flourish and bear fruit in the good times. And we can be gardeners too, the waterers, the feeders, the sowers, the reapers, the preparers, the hosts of thanksgiving and celebration. We can be all these things. So I hope you've found something in what we've shared in our service today that helped you grow just that little bit more. And now we're going to have our next hymn. It's from Singing the Faith, number 45, and it's called Earth's Creator, and it's sung here by Ruth and Joy Everingham.
Come be with us.
And now Irene Dacres is going to lead our prayers.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for all you are and all you continue to be in our lives. You never change. You are constantly with us through all circumstances. We are amazed at how growth and changes happen. We pray especially for Strathclyde Circuit as we emerge from the pandemic and look to grow in new and exciting ways, embracing technology to develop church, to reach out and extend our boundaries. Be our guide and direction as we explore new online possibilities as a circuit. We bring before you each church in our circuit and the community within them. Strengthen and encourage your people to grow more like Jesus, to care for the vulnerable, lonely and hurting around us. Keep us focused in being praying communities, listening for your direction and prompting us. Open our eyes to see new possibilities and enable us to embrace each step forward. Let us lead step by step as we move from isolated lockdown to a wider circle, albeit with tentative steps. You, Lord, want your church, your people, to flourish in every way possible. As the smallest seed can become the biggest of plants, may we too flourish and grow from the tiniest of thoughts and ideas and blossom into the people and communities you would have us be. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We often think there's not much we can do to affect climate change within our families. But here are some ideas, five broad sections that will give you some food for thought. Perhaps you could start by taking on one or two of the smaller points and then consider where to go next. Firstly, food. Eating food lower on the food chain or eliminating meat and dairy entirely is one of the most effective ways of cutting carbon. You can buy less, waste less.
Transport. Travel by bike, carpool, take public transport as often as possible. And when planning your next family holiday, carefully consider the need for flights. Holiday more local or opt for a shorter flight.
Heating. 80% of our residential energy consumption comes from heating space and water. Wash clothes in cold water. Take shorter showers. Turn off the lights. Or be even more radical and move to a smaller, more energy efficient home.
Recycle, reduce, reuse. Make reduce and reuse the priority. This will have a lasting impact on the environment. Plan carefully and buy only what you need. Buy less stuff. Be aware the recycling industry is complex, and much of what we put in the recycling bins ends up in landfills.
Influence. Changes can begin with small steps, like educating yourself on the evidence, causes and effects of climate change. Children are constant observers of adults' choices. Many kids will notice when an adult makes an effort to reduce waste and carbon emissions. Make the effort. To emphasise these changes further, explain what your actions and choices mean for the environment.
You can find more information at theconversation.com, 5 ways families can help tackle climate change, 126512. I hope this is helpful, and I hope it gives you a step for a hint.
And now for our final hymn, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky, number 663 in Singing the Faith. And it's sung here by North Allerton Methodist Church.
Oh, And now a final prayer. And it's taken from this wee book here, which is called 9 Days of Prayer, I Hear You Differently. Let us pray. Listening God, it is hard not to know what will happen next. Whether we are going to grieve or rejoice, what good news might look like, what bad news might imply. Help us not to rush ahead, but to live with unknowing, to dwell in your uncomfortable mystery. Amen.